Because I don't, I want to kind of see the okay, now it's okay. Well, hello everyone, thank you so much for being here today. I'm very happy that many of you are joining. This is going to be a talk that I organize with University of Brussels and my colleagues at our complexity center here in Brussels. And the theme, as is described on the basically poster, it's about post-COVID-19 society. So I really appreciate just the people who are just the speakers keep their videos on and the speakers on. The rest, I really appreciate if you mute your microphone. Thank you. So I am very happy to host these three wonderful speakers. I have Dr. Cadell Las. He's a philosopher and a multidisciplinary thinker. And he kindly accepted our invitation to present his perspectives and views on how can we as collectives, as societies, can learn from COVID-19 and how we can emerge as more resilient and stronger societies. So without giving any more kind of explanation, I think it's best to listen to his talk, and there we go. Thank you.
Okay, so I'm coming through clear. Just a sec. Let's see if I can do a screen. Can I do a screen share?
I think
yeah. Yeah. Okay. I'm just going to see. Can you guys see my presentation? It should say tools for self-exploration.
Perfect.
That's ever. It's showing up. Okay. Okay. So this talk is really just a an introduction to some tools for self-exploration that I have been personally exploring over the quarantine and self-isolation. And the point really of giving this talk, I think, is just that a lot of us might feel disempowered. A lot of us might feel frustrated just because the state of the world is so much out of our control. We might have, lost our job or lost some opportunity, or just feel stressed out just about the nature of the problem, just that it's so like I said, out of our control. But there are many things in our control, and there are many opportunities to explore during the COVID-19 pandemic. And the way I've personally approached it is just to go inwards. I just used it to go deeper inwards. And even though society is out of our control, this could be a very interesting opportunity to explore our relationship to the body, explore the relationship between the mind and the body. Of course, the mind-body problem is an ancient philosophical problem, and these are some tools and of course this little image here you see of six different tools. This is not by any means an exhaustive list of things. This could be many different tools. It could be journaling, could be yoga, could be whatever it is that you use to explore the mind-body relationship. These are just six things that I've personally can speak a little bit from experience about. So without further ado, I'll just get into the six. It shouldn't take that long, and then pass it on to the next speaker. So the first thing is breath work. The two most probably well-known experts on breath work that I've been learning from is Wim Hof and Stan Grof. I'm not sure if I'm pronouncing his first name right, but you can look up Stan Grof's work online. He's a very famous psychologist who has been patenting a technique called holotropic breathwork for several decades now. The reason why breath work is so important, in my view, is because breathing is really an elementary and primal relationship that consciousness has to being in a body and being in the world. You might even say it's the most elementary input and output that that consciousness has with the body as soon as it's separated from the mother. And breath work is also important because it connects consciousness directly to this breathing process, whereas oftentimes we're breathing unconsciously. You're not consciously thinking, I am breathing. But breath work is where you really bring the attention and the focus of consciousness to your breathing process, and you augment it in different ways. Like if you look up holotropic breath work, there's a certain technique, a certain set and setting that you're trying to cultivate in order to really bring consciousness to the breath. And oftentimes what people experience during cultivating a conscious relationship to their breath is a new relationship to the, what I would call the emotional historical body. Oftentimes people will have rushes of emotions and sensations and memories from their past, which will spontaneously come up to consciousness. Most people I've heard say that this mechanism at work when this is happening is basically a loosening or a relaxation of the rational mind, of the thoughts that are normally occupying our primary identity, our waking consciousness identity. And therefore, during the breath work, when you're first starting out, it can be extremely difficult if past emotions are coming up. It can be emotionally difficult in terms of negative emotions, crying, but you can also experience spontaneous laughter. You can experience spontaneous, you know, huge waves of positivity and joy. For me, it really sends, like, you know, my body feels like it's electric, you know, my hands in particular. So I recommend exploring this. It can be an interesting way to, it can be an interesting way not only to explore your breath, but also the way in which exploring your breath can change your relationship to your body. The second practice I've been exploring during the pandemic is meditation, and I've run some meditation challenges. Of course, meditation is a very common tool. There's many different forms of meditation, active, dynamic, and of course, meditation with the breath as well. And meditation is an essential component to many different spiritual traditions in the East and West. Basically, in its most simplest essence, in its like the elementary, you know, dimension of meditation upon which you can build, is just silence with oneself. I'm talking right now, usually in our rational waking life, thoughts are constantly running through our mind, and in our working life, we're usually using our rational consciousness to interact with others. Meditation is really the opposite of that mode of consciousness, where you're simply in silence, in quiet contemplation with oneself. And the standard sort of, I wouldn't say belief, but the standard sort of experiential discovery that emerges from meditation is that there is a little bit of a gap, a little bit of a distance that you can create between you as an observer and the thoughts, the words, the images that are normally running through our minds. And that this is usually, although not always, coupled with an experience of peace and stillness, as opposed to when we're constantly identified with our minds, there can be, you know, contradictions and conflicts of ideas, thoughts, words, images, and so forth. And we can feel overwhelmed that the incessant movement of our mind. So this can be a way I often say that, you know, it's not something that is going to obviously solve all of your problems or something like that, but it can be a nice place to cultivate, where if you are, you know, stressed out or feeling tension, if you have built up a meditation practice, this can be a type of inner sanctuary, a place of peace and stillness. The third thing I've been exploring over the COVID-19 pandemic more and more is cold and hot water immersion. There are many different forms of cold and hot water immersion, but for me, I'm just doing it very simply in the shower. I'll get up, put on the extremely cold, I'll force myself in, and of course, it's always a shock to the body. But what it does is it really is a beautiful way for the mind to feel the body. And it just makes you alert. It wakes you up. I, just as an anecdotal, there is like a lot of scientific evidence on the benefits of cold and hot water immersion, which I'm not going to go fully into, but I can speak from anecdotal evidence, which I think is very interesting, which I haven't gotten sick since I started doing cold water immersion, which I think is very interesting. Of course, that's anecdotal, but there is a lot of scientific evidence that cold water immersion is good for your immune system and so forth. But on a deeper level, it really does make the mind more alert and brings the mind into a deeper relationship with body processes, just because you are exposing your body to extremes of temperature which are normally not experienced, and also you do feel like a sense of accomplishment, like you get up in the morning and you do that because the sense of accomplishment, I think, comes from, you know, it is kind of difficult to throw yourself into the extreme cold, and your body's evolutionary history isn't really well adapted to this experience. So, you know, it's an interesting thing to play with. The next one, lucid dreaming, is something I'm really a rookie at. I'm a rookie at lucid dreaming, and it's something that I anticipate is going to become a bigger and bigger part of my existence. As soon as I heard about lucid dreaming, I was fascinated by it. Basically what it is, and I've had spontaneous lucid dreams, but trying to get a better understanding of how to consciously control when I'm lucid dreaming. But basically what lucid dreaming is, it is conscious control over unconscious dream processes. Many people throughout their life will have a recognition that I'm awake during, or I'm dreaming, or like basically we'll have the realization that I'm dreaming, but they'll be conscious of it in their dream. But there is actually ways, and there's more and more people now who are exploring this. There are ways to become an expert at lucid dreaming, where you can control if you want a lucid dream when you go to sleep at night. There are a few different techniques for this. A lot of people say, for example, that you should, in the waking hours, just while you're sitting by yourself, ask yourself, am I dreaming? And the more you ask yourself during your waking hours, if you're dreaming, the more your unconscious will include this repetition into your psyche, basically. And you'll start to ask yourself this while you're dreaming. And if you ask yourself this while you're dreaming, there are also little subtle sensory cues you can do. Like you can set a very light alarm for like a time when you think you are anticipate you'll be REM sleeping, like 2 a.m. or 3 a.m. And you might hear that sound in your dream, and it could cue a lucid dream, for example. There are different cues you can use to basically play with this. But when you do achieve the state of lucid dreaming, you can totally play with desire. You can do basically anything you want. It's an unbounded and unconstrained freedom in the image. So a lot of people go on adventures. You know, I have a friend who lucid dreams, who says every time she lucid dreams, she flies, for example. You know, so it can just be a little space of freedom and an interesting way to explore your consciousness. The fifth, and one more after this, and then I'm done. The fifth is fasting. Fasting is an interesting practice I would like to put into conversation with breath work, because breath work is an elementary input-output relationship with consciousness and the body. But food is maybe the next closest connection for input and output in terms of relationship with the body. So a lot of people can go their entire life without ever having a consciously mediated abstinence from food and water, which basically means you've never challenged this most basic relationship between the mind and the body. And when you first start doing it, it can be, again, extremely emotional, because a lot of processes which are usually being sort of blocked with the relationship with food have to come to consciousness, essentially. So, and also you actually experience a positive dimension of hunger and thirst. The most intimate relationship I have with fasting is that absence or the lack of something becomes a positive feature. It can actually be a strange type of enjoyment. And of course, different forms of body processes start to operate when you're fasting. And if you're, especially if you're meditating at the same time, it can be a great way to feel different dimensions of your body at work. So I won't go too much more into that, but of course, if, you know, I'm assuming for a lot of people, you know, you've either done this stuff, or if you haven't done it, you know, you might know something about it, or maybe explored it a little bit yourself. But if you haven't explored this at all, I of course recommend for all of these things to just, you know, look into them first and read and educate yourself and make your own decision about your own relationship to them. But I will say on the fasting aspect that you should go into it, if you do explore it for the first time, you know, slowly. Don't do an extreme fast right away. Do it slowly and build up your relationship to this. Then the final thing I'll say is psychedelics. Psychedelics, I anticipate that psychedelics, like the research on psychedelics, the research on psychedelics now is exploding. So if you see the history of the research on psychedelics, it was in the 60s, then it was shut down. Now, in between 2015 and 2020, psychedelic research is exploding, basically for mental health care, for depression, anxiety, PTSD, terminal illness. Psychedelics are going to be applied, I anticipate, on a mass scale, probably in the next 5 years. And all the rules and regulations about it are going to be changing. So I know it's illegal. I know it's difficult, but there are many legal ways to get psychedelics. And basically what they do is they manifest altered states of consciousness. Many people call them entheogens, which simply means generating the divine within. And the most common aspect of psychedelic experience is a dissolution of duality and space-time, and basically a relationship to what many people describe as a sacred form of consciousness. They can be, like I say here on the slide, spiritually meaningful. They can improve your existential attitude, and they tend to lead towards more creative openness. And I think that why this happens is because on psychedelics, there's many studies now that show that the normal default mode network of consciousness, which is operating in your brain, is totally transformed when you're on psychedelics, and you have your whole brain is operating on different forms of connections than your default mode network of consciousness. So worth doing research on that. There's a lot of literature. Of course, reach out to me. You can reach out to me through email on cadell.last@gmail.com if you have questions, or if you have questions here for Shima to moderate. But these are the things I've been exploring on COVID-19. And again, the point for me is, you know, of course it can feel overwhelming, the situation socially, collectively, globally. But there is a space where we can use this time to better understand ourselves and to better understand our body. And Shima, thank you for the invitation, and I'll pass it on to you.
Well, thank you so much, Cadell. Such an interesting discussion and such a enlightening presentation. I find it very interesting how you connected all of these aspects of mind and body within this realm of infinity. And I think what came to my mind was that it seems that the extreme situation with COVID-19 is such that actually it pushes us to imagine something that we haven't imagined. So it's a really like an open space for us to really explore who we are at core. And I think all of these components are truly valuable in helping us maybe unlock some of the deepest values that might have been missing before this crisis. So at this moment, I don't want to make any more comments, and I have some questions here also on Instagram because I'm streaming it live as well. So I keep it with you for after all the presentation. But thank you, Cadell. Now I pass the screen to Dr. Marius. Thank you so much for joining us.
Hello. As soon as Cadell comes out, I'll see if I can share my screen.
Is my screen still on, or?
Yes, I can see it.
I think I can stop it. I think I stopped sharing. Okay, so now you can stop.
Let's see what's going on here. Well, I'm going to talk about some background information about the epidemic and analyze a few sets of events that happened. And maybe try to explain what happened and why it happened and how we are going to learn from it. So I'm going to base it on my own experience because I went as a volunteer to the local hospital and I work in the front line. And I saw many things that troubled me or many things that explained many questions that I had in my mind. First of all, the thing that happened is that the whole system panicked. And I assume this is the same in different countries as well, in your countries. It was an unknown situation. And everybody went into a panic mode. And as soon as some of the persons in the hospital tested positive, even if they were asymptomatic, they sent them all home. So there were no doctors and no nurses. And they had to ask other unrelated doctors like myself, who I'm not working now, to go in. And they said to me, do your best. We don't know what to do. We don't have any plan. Do your best. And this had an impact on the patient and on the way the epidemic was presented. There was no proper isolating procedure. So the patient infected from each other. Many patients who were negative on testing, something funny happened because the test to come back for the result to come back it takes 4 days. So the patient is ready to go home. They do a test, they wait for 4 days for the result to come back. And then when it comes back negative, they say, yes, but now you've been in for 4 days and maybe you caught it again, so we'll do it again. And they keep doing it until the patient dies. This in my view, may explain why we see such, partly explain anyway, why we see such high numbers of deaths. And then there are some ethical questions and ethical matters that I've noticed. One of the most serious, in my view, was that because they don't allow visitors to go into hospital to see their relative, they are afraid of contacting it from each other. So all the patients in all the hospitals in Cyprus, from what I've seen in many other parts of the world, they are without visitors until they either die or are discharged to go home. I know a few cases of patients who went in with different reasons, cancer or renal failure, and they stayed in for several days, weeks, and then they die. And when they die, the protocol is to put them in a bag, plastic bag, and put it in a seal container and give it to the relatives, but directly into the grave, so you don't see your dead relative. This has caused quite a lot of problems, and I've tried to notify the different authorities with the media and so on. And it remains as a problem. And also, many patients may die or may get sick without because they don't get the proper care due to the scare of the epidemic. So we have extra deaths, which wouldn't have happened, but they happen because of the bad care. And also many people get some other disease, heart trouble or any other chest problems, and they are afraid to go into the hospital because they are afraid to not to get the infection. So all of this contributes to the partly to the excess death rate we've seen. And then going back into the biochemical, biostatistical issues, people ask me, we do so many tests and we have so many cases of COVID. What kind of test is it? Is it reliable? Some people buy it from the local market, pharmaceutical market, others through the hospital, others through different providers. We had tests sent to us from Israel, Greece, France. So we don't know. My answer is we don't know. And I've said about the way they test the cases. At the beginning, they may do, for example, 100 tests, you'll find some positive. If you do 10,000 tests, you'll find more positive. It doesn't mean that it doesn't mean that the cases are increasing. It means that we are identifying them better. But this is something that caused panic in the population, and it will lead to the next stage, which I'll discuss in a minute, because when the population is in panic, they may do anything that you tell them. But from the medical point of view, there is also the issue of how many deaths we have prevented against how many deaths we have caused, because one particular group is the older population, who if you isolate them at home for a long period, then the cause of the number of deaths increase due to other causes, psychological problems, drug problems, suicide, and then we've seen such things happening. Just to tie in the global brain idea, I found it interesting to see how the spread of information moves around the world and how it is influenced by what other people feel or think or believe. We've seen many fake news which people have believed straight away, or they identified straight away as fake. And this reminds me a bit of identifying a virus in your body, whether it's something to fight or something to allow. It's like a immune system of the body. And the media played a lot of part in this in a negative way by constantly bombarding us with news, numbers, how many men, how many women, which town had so many men, what ages, constantly. I think this is a lot to do with the way the media is presenting it, and thus influencing people a lot in a bad way unless it is controlled. One question I have is, when I see all these people staying at home, not doing anything, and just waiting there or posting silly things on social media, or cooking again and then posting things again, is this the life we want to live? A life closed in a house, not doing anything? I've seen some civil liberties being taken away, apart from the individual people who are in lockdown in their houses. We've seen voices who try to present another point of view being silenced by somebody. They cut off their YouTube channels, or they take down their postings. And this for me is a question: who does this? Who is it, something behind it, or is it just happening because it's happening spontaneously? One thing I've noticed is we are talking about resilience. It's going to be a problem because we cannot come up with something that covers everybody. Many societies are different. The people are different. The way they think are different. There are different variations, the well-known variations, but also people change day by day. So one day they may think and accept one thing, and the next day they may change it and accept something else. So this for me is a problem of how to build a resilient society and how to build something that can be applicable to everybody or to many people at the same time without going into personalized interventions. Something that Cadell said, which is for general advice for everybody to do. I don't know whether it will work in individual situations, in individual people. And for me, this has been an opportunity to adapt to a new challenge. I saw this as a challenge that upset my normal daily routine. We try to avoid daily routine anyway, but that was an opportunity. And it's something that we have to adapt and change towards the better, not towards the worst. Many people have become depressed or anxious. They changed, they adapted, but they adapted in a bad way towards one step back instead of doing one step forward. My own example was that due to the lockdown, everything was cancelled for me. So all my activities were cancelled. The face-to-face activities were cancelled. But I tried to fight back by creating new opportunities for me to act in a new niche of people who are willing to listen and adapt with me. So positive things that I've seen. It was a good thing that we use more social media and distance learning through digital means. We've seen that here, and people have begun to discover that for all ages as well, for older people as well. We work with some associates here to promote meaningful viewing of video games. And generally, the idea made a step for the society made a step forward in accepting a digitalized society, which is, let's say, towards the global brain, one step nearer. And the spread of information, it remains a problem because it has to be the positive information that we accept and use and avoid the negative information, which for me remains a problem. Maybe we'll discuss this later. So that's all for now. We can discuss things as they come. Thank you. Sorry, I can't hear you.
Okay, so is it okay now? The sound?
Now I hear you, okay. Yes.
I said thank you for the presentation. Yeah. I can see that, of course, the point of view from medical point of view, there are, of course, different perspectives on COVID-19. However, I think what was very interesting while I was listening to you was the I think the common denominator between your concerns and the previous speaker, Cadell, was this our capacity to somehow deal with the flow of information. I mean, the information could be generated through, I mean, the crisis that we're experiencing through our mind and body, but also the information that is flowing through our system. So in a way, I think there are so a kind of pattern is emerging that our capacity to deal with information might be something that we can take from this talk and then connect it to Francis's talk next, and then we can kind of discuss further. Okay, Francis, can you can unmute yourself now? Maybe you can start. Okay.
Yes, and I will share the screen.
It should be at the bottom.
Okay. No. Apparently I chose the wrong screen. And you have lots of windows open, and it's not obvious which one. That should be the one. Yes. Okay, that's the one. Okay. So I have titled my talk, Some Reflections on the Aftermath of the COVID-19 Pandemic. So I'm trying to look forward, which of course is at this moment very difficult, so this is all very speculative. But I'm thinking in terms of that this COVID-19 pandemic is a severe shock to the system. And by the system, I mean the whole of human society. So we know that in the most affected countries, we can have up to 1,000 deaths per million inhabitants, which is quite a lot. Largely the elderly and those with underlying health conditions, and that in lots of places, the clinical facilities are overloaded, and so people don't get the care they deserve. That's the medical problems that that Marios has been speaking about. We have a second problem, which is that because of this pandemic, there has been a nearly global lockdown, meaning that people are not supposed to come out of their houses for their more traditional activities. So most physical interactions have been interrupted. And that may lead to a number of other problems. People staying at home, feeling isolated, feeling depressed, being anxious, not getting the help they need. That has also led to the disruption of most of the economic activities. So lots of people cannot do their job. So they are at least temporarily unemployed. But potentially, if that continues, they may permanently lose their job because the firm for which they work gets bankrupt by lack of income. We also have seen an interruption of international travel, which is something that hasn't happened in a very long time. Even during the 9/11 aftermath, there was still travel shortly afterwards. So the fact that now there are hardly any planes flying across the world is something novel for the period of the last 50 years at least. And maybe another big shock is that there is a great uncertainty about what's going to happen next. When is this going to stop? Is it going to get worse? Is it going to get better? Is the lockdown going to last a few more weeks or a few more months? Or maybe will something like this go on for years? We don't know. That makes planning and investment decisions for longer term things very precarious. So that is the shock to the system. But now, as a person specialized in complex systems, I can say that sometimes shocks can be beneficial. And that is something that is called in cybernetics the order from noise principle, which means that if you shake a system in the sense that you introduce some random perturbations, it may get the system out of a suboptimal equilibrium and into one that is better. It may get the system out of the valley in which it is, and maybe in a deeper valley, which is more stable, which is a better equilibrium. In technical language, we move the system from a shallow attractor to a deeper attractor, where the deeper attractor is more resilient or more sustainable. In a more common formulation, the principle has been formulated by the philosopher Nietzsche as that which does not kill me makes me stronger. So assuming that this pandemic does not kill the global economic system, it may make it stronger. Now, I don't believe in this form that Nietzsche says it, that everything that does not kill me makes me stronger. It could almost kill you and make you weaker, but there is also the possibility that some serious stress may actually build the system into more strong form. Why is that important? Because I think most people agree that the present global socioeconomic system is unsustainable as such. Something needs to be done, something needs to change. So giving it a shock may help it to reach this more sustainable configuration. Of course, as I said, a shock can also have negative effect. It could also make things worse. For example, this uncertainty about the future may people reduce their investment in the alternative energy technologies that we will need to combat global warming. It may strengthen totalitarian forms of governments. It may create a general climate of fear, which tends to lead to more maybe populism, totalitarianism, or fundamentalism. But I'm not going to discuss these negative scenarios here. As personally somebody who tends to look on the bright side as an optimist, I will here just limit myself to some of the plausible positive effects. I don't guarantee that those positive effects will be there. I'm not claiming that the negative effects won't be there. I'm just saying that in the midst of all this doom and gloom, it's not bad to remind people to look at maybe some of the more obvious, some of the less obvious positive effects to counter this focus on the more obvious negative effects. So let's start with the effects on the economy and the ecology. So we know that our present consumption pattern is unsustainable, and the fact that the whole economy has slowed down obviously leads to less energy consumption. Less consumption of non-essential goods that are based on other non-renewable sources, less plane and other travel. Therefore, generally speaking, the CO2 production has gone down a lot. I don't know how much it is now, but at a certain moment I saw that it was 8%, but that was already a month ago, so there might be more even now. Assuming that the economy will not immediately catch up, that may last a little bit longer, thus buying us some more time to combat global warming. More importantly, I think, is that this whole crisis will lead us to question the prevailing economic model. And why should we question this prevailing economic model? Not only because of the unsustainability, but because we see that in the present state of the economy, the fact that a number of non-essential services, like, let's say, tourism, clothing, sales, entertainment, that may actually lead to a collapse of the economy. Why is that? From the very simple principle that if people can't sell things that normally they sell, they don't get any income. If they don't get any income, they can't buy things from other firms. Those other firms therefore will also not get any income, and you have this kind of a positive feedback. It's a vicious cycle, the chain reaction of one bankruptcy causing another bankruptcy. It's the same kind of principle that led to the financial collapse in 2009. So there is the danger that this thing would happen. And why? Because people, let's say for a few months, didn't go to buy clothing in shops and didn't go to restaurants. Now we can say, yeah, of course, that's very bad for these people who have clothing shops or who have restaurants. But an economy in itself should not collapse just because certain non-essential services are temporarily interrupted. So why is that problem? It is because we are in a capitalist economy that can only function when money circulates. So the fact that somebody is rich and has money and has all he needs, that's not enough for the money for the economy to work. That person must spend the money. So the principle of the capitalist economy is you must spend money even if you don't need anything. And that's the whole point of the consumption society. You need to consume to get the economy going. So even if you spend your money just for frivolous or unsustainable products, that is necessary for the economy to continue, and the economy doesn't care between important products that are truly needed and products that are just in fashion or just unhealthy. So the conclusion, I think, is what hopefully a number of people will draw, is that a market economy that is so vulnerable that if certain non-essential services are interrupted for a few months, the whole thing may collapse, that is not the kind of economy that you want to have. So that means we should start thinking about alternatives. So what are some of these alternatives that, among others, the people in our group have been thinking about? Well, one of the most obvious ones, and one that apparently even Trump has been considering, is a basic income, which is the idea that people get money, a fixed minimal income sufficient to survive no matter what. So even if you are a restaurant owner and for 3 or 4 months you don't get any income because it's not allowed for people to visit as a restaurant, you would not starve. You would be able still to pay your medical costs, to send your kids to school. That is the idea. The idea of a basic income is that it creates a buffer, it creates a reserve, so that no matter what shock there is to the system that may interrupt temporary loss of income, people do not immediately suffer, they can continue. And that second advantage of the basic income is that it creates a general feeling of security. So people who know that they will have an income, they are more daring to invest in more long-term projects, things that are typically more risky, but also more creative, things that you wouldn't otherwise dare to do, because if it fails, you wouldn't have any income at all. While now, you might be willing to try something out, which, if successful, may be a very big advantage for humanity. But if it fails, you don't have anything. You would still fall back on this basic income. Another thing that hopefully will be incited by the COVID-19 pandemic is that we need to tax what I call extreme wealth, not only of individuals, but of companies who gather billions and billions of dollars and basically don't pay any taxes on that because through various offshore constructions and other legal loopholes, they manage to evade those taxes. Now, there will be a lot of costs from the pandemic. Governments will, for example, need to subsidize all kinds of businesses that otherwise might collapse. Those governments will need to pay that somehow. They can't ask that money from the people who themselves don't have much, because that will be bad for the economy as well. Hopefully, through the pandemic, they may be sufficiently motivated to agree among each other to make some measures to really tax that wealth that is at the moment hiding from the taxman. There's an even more radical way of creating a new economy. It's also an idea that's in our Santa Lea Apostle Group and the Global Brain Institute we have been thinking about, is something that we call the offer networks. And an offer network, it's originally an idea of our colleague Ben Goertzel, but one that I and others have been developing further. It's the idea that we have a sharing economy, but at the moment the sharing economy is still quite a capitalist economy, in the sense that there are lots of companies that are, for example, making available taxis or electrical bikes, but in the traditional way by making money for it. So the offer network is an idea of a sharing economy, meaning that you share things with others, but without money. And how can you do that? Well, actually, before money existed, there existed economic systems in villages and in tribes that were based on what is called gift and barter. Most people think that barter was the main thing there, that you exchanged one good for one other thing, but barter is not very efficient. Gift economies are economies where you just give somebody that you don't need, and sooner or later when you need something, somebody else will give it to you. So it's this idea, but now we are going to use ICT, information and communication technology, and artificial algorithms to scale that to a much larger network. That means thousands or millions of people are in the network. And the principle is simple, that everybody in the network makes available a list of what they need and a list of what they are ready to offer. And the network just matches so that ideally everybody gets what they need and everybody gives what they want to offer. I'm not going to explain the mathematics behind it, but there are some algorithms to do that. Another domain in which the system is shocked, but in such a way that there may be some positive effects, well, society. Well, first of all, because of the whole reduction in international travel, the globalization process will be slowed down. I don't believe it will be stopped, but it will be slowed down, and that will reduce some of the pressures that are on the system, in particular the pressure of people immigrating from poorer countries to richer countries, which tends to lead to nationalist and populist parties in those richer countries. That immigration pressure, I expect, will at least temporarily reduce, giving the whole system more time to deal with it. Another more general effect is, hopefully, that through the pandemic, people will become more aware of how globally interdependent we are. And the reason is simply that the virus does not respect borders or nationalities. And even if you stop all travel in between continents or in between countries, you cannot stop a virus at your national border. That is simply impossible. What's more also is that we have learned that the virus probably comes from bats or some other wild animals. So we also know that viruses don't even care about borders between humans and nature, that's to say animals living in the wild. Whatever happens somewhere in a rainforest in the Amazon may have an effect on our health, positive or negative. another awareness of interdependence is that at least within countries, people tend to exhibit more solidarity between each other. There are plenty of volunteers who are wanting to help people who, for example, start making face masks. At this moment, unfortunately, because of the closing of the borders and the fact that each country is kind of scrambling to get everything for its own citizens, that solidarity is not yet sufficiently cross-border, but hopefully when things relax a little bit, there will also be more cross-border solidarity, like countries that are particularly good in producing respirators, sending respirators to countries where they don't have respirators. Another positive effect that Mario's already mentioned is that now people have, in a sense, been forced to use the internet to do all kind of work, which before they were still doing in the traditional way. That means you can do a lot of work actually without needing to travel from your home to your office. And according generally to surveys, most people prefer to be able to work from home at least some of the days in the week. It's probably not a good idea to have people stay at home the whole week and do all their work from home, but there definitely is not a good reason why people should work 5 days a week at an office if they can do half of that work at home. And we also, by using all these internet tools, we will learn to use these tools more efficiently, and we will learn that it is indeed for some tasks more efficient to do it online. I'm not saying that a face-to-face workshop doesn't have advantages over this kind of a Zoom meeting, but Zoom meetings may have certain other advantages that a face-to-face meeting doesn't have. So by forcing people to experiment with these things, we will teach them also to discover the better uses and to avoid the less good uses. Another effect, maybe less obvious, is that governments have been taking some radical measures. I mean, in normal times, nobody would ever have thought that the government would dare to impose a measure that people should not leave their houses. I mean, except for war, situation that has never happened. So the fact that now they had to do it, and not only they had to do it, but most people accepted that as being reasonable in the circumstances, in a sense empowers the government again. Because at the moment in our present society, there has been a tendency to take away more and more powers away from governments and to give those to the markets. And it's not, as people think, that that is more democratic. It's rather the opposite, because the market, that means it's the biggest firms that have the most money, they have the most power, and they are not elected. And if they use their power for wrong purposes, they cannot be voted out. A government, assuming, of course, that it's a democratic government, can be voted out if it abuses its power. So the fact that democratic governments now have been forced to take these radical measures may make them think that maybe, yes, we can take some other measures, because some other measures are necessary to combat global warming and to redistribute wealth. I spoke about, for example, these taxes on the wealthiest people. Well, most governments don't really dare to do that, because there's wealthy people, of course, they can lobby well, and they have all kinds of other means to put pressure on governments. But maybe now those governments will be less afraid to take these radical measures, which are really necessary. Another possible positive effect that Marius was hinting at is that we have seen a lot of fake news about the COVID crisis, but in this case, I think everybody agrees that this fake news is really dangerous. Fake news that tells you, for example, like Iran, that drinking alcohol would kill the virus, and then people were illegally producing alcohol, drank from it, and died from it. Fake news is not just freedom of opinion. So, I mean, there is always this dangerous border between not allowing people things to say, and then in that way suppressing their freedom of opinion, and not making things that are dangerous and definitely untrue spread as if they are true. So we still need to develop a good policy to distinguish between freedom of expression and the spread of dangerous fake news. But by the fact that this fake news now at this moment really can cost lives, I think everybody will be again motivated to do something about it. How can you do something about it? At the very least, rely more on fact checkers, relying more on scientific evidence, and have these echo chambers and bubbles in the social media do something about the algorithms that make this news propagate so quickly. We know that, for example, in Facebook, the fact that somebody puts something on his web page, on his Facebook page, if enough people click on it that they like it, it automatically spreads. And of course, the fact that somebody likes a message does not at all make it true or make it not dangerous. So there should be some other way to control propagation than just the fact that some people somewhere like it. So, by the way, that's something I just heard on the news. In Congo, a doctor was saying that the spread of false news is actually more difficult to control than the spread of the virus. And in Congo, there are lots of rumors about what the virus is or what to do about it. Rumors such as, for example, that the virus only can kill white men, that black people are not immune to it. That's of course a dangerously false news. And so this particular doctor in Congo was comparing the spread of false news to the spread of the virus itself. Finally, the last positive effect that the pandemic may have is that it reminds us to the fact that our bodies are vulnerable to natural, uncontrollable events. That means that we cannot purely rely on some technological fix. That means some big pharmaceutical company that develops a drug and then the problem is solved. That has been the dominant model in healthcare at the moment. Spend a lot of money in order to produce one particular molecule that is supposed to cure one particular disease. What we need to be reminded of is that diseases are basically a question of our whole body, and that this whole body should be maximally healthy and strengthened. And in particular, we should strengthen our immune system. And the immune system is an extremely complex system. There isn't a single drug that is going to replace your immune system. Some observations why this is particularly important, the strengthening of our immune system. We notice that the virus is most lethal for people with the weakest overall health, and in particular with a number of pre-existing conditions. And these pre-existing conditions are what has been called diseases of civilization, the kind of diseases you typically find in modern Western societies. Things like diabetes, obesity, coronary heart disease, cancer. And also, interestingly, I just read a study this morning that somebody has made a correlation between the number of people dying from COVID in 20 European countries and the average vitamin D levels in the blood. And it turns out that there is a strong correlation. The higher the vitamin D levels, the less people in the country die. So why are vitamin D levels low? Because people do not subject themselves to sunshine. So that means strengthening our body. That means going back to what I would call a more natural lifestyle that can strengthen our immunity. The classic elements are there. A healthy diet means sufficient vegetables, fruit, proteins, vitamins, fibers and other nutrients, regular and diverse physical exercise, exposure to sunlight, exposure to heat and cold. That's also what Cadell was telling us about, the hot and cold bouts. Of course, avoidance of the bad things of a present civilization, the junk food, of course, the smoking and the air pollution. So hopefully, once people understand that there is no miracle cure for the COVID, in the sense that there does not seem to be any vaccine that is expected within a short period, that means it will still be around probably for at least the next year. In the meantime, the only thing we can do is strengthen our immune system. That means implementing all these common sense health rules, but which people tend to be keeping off for no good reason, except that, yeah, it's just easier to eat junk food than to do sports. So that was my list of potential positive effects, where the general idea is it's a shock to the system. The shock exposes some of the weaknesses of the system and therefore motivates us to look for alternatives for these weak points. Okay, I'll stop sharing my screen.
Thank you so much, Francis, for your presentation. I think what I would like to say right now is that from resilience perspective, what I find very relevant is this, just a moment. Okay, apologies. What I would like to say that from resilience perspective, what you explained, assuming that COVID-19 is a form of an extreme shock that can potentially push our systems out of its normal equilibrium, and subjecting us to a new kind of equilibrium that we are not, we are yet to basically discover and to adapt to. However, I think I can understand the point that you're making in terms of this extreme of COVID-19 pushing us out of the collective equilibrium. But at the same time, I think given that some of our previous systems are highly resilient in a bad way to the way they used to be, how could we, how could COVID-19 be an extreme shock for them if they still want to keep the business as usual and the way they were doing, even though that is not sustainable? So in a way, what I would like to kind of clarify is that even though that our discussion today, it's about resilience, it's about kind of developing resilience and kind of exploring what could be new value systems of post-COVID-19 societies. Resilience in itself, it's not necessarily a positive attribute. Sometimes our systems are very resilient, but in a very bad way, as we see like our previous systems are. Have not been sustainable. The other connection that I would like to, I mean, the comment that I would like to make is that the point you're making about a preparing us, exposing ourselves to more, I mean, being forced to use internet, as also Marius was explaining, as more of a tool that allows us to reduce the kind of commuting that we tend to do in before COVID-19. However, I think at the same time, it exposes a paradox, I think. On one hand, we are talking about a kind of information society that we would like to have, in an information society in its essence that is informing us of things. But at the same time, we as individuals are, I think, are also exposed in our capacity to understand what is actually information and what is misinformation. So it seems that there is this underlying gap in terms of our understanding as collectives, as what it is a meaningful source of information, and how could we be contributors to this kind of highly aware and mindful societies that we are all, I think, speaking about. And with that said, I think I would like to also to invite Cadell and also Marius, kind of unmute yourself and start if you have any comment and basically elaborating more of the points that each of you made, I think it would be very interesting. And for the listeners and also those that are listening here live, if you have any question, please submit it to the chat box and here on the comment.
I have a comment about fake news. How do we know that something is fake? For example, if something stupid or silly, we can identify it straight away, like drinking Dettol, we know it's silly. But if somebody presents something which is appears reasonable, we have something in Greece, a company or a group of people called Hellenic hoaxes, and their job is to fact check everything and present an opinion whether the news are true or they are fake. And many times they present evidence that something is fake, but other times they present just their opinion balanced on probabilities. And recently they've been accused of promote fake news. So the fact checking organization promotes fake news. So this is something which is problematic in identifying what's fake and what isn't, unless it's very, very clear.
I think what was also, I think it's what came to my mind while you were explaining about the possibility of fake news. I mean, both you and Francis mentioned about this, the challenge of fake news. But at the same time, what is a little bit of dichotomy for me is that this information about COVID-19 and what we need to do and the kind of information that we need actually to adapt, they seem to be not being news actually. There are more like sources of information. So if this is true, I was wondering to ask that, do you think our current news companies, whether it be Fox or what have you, BBC or CNN or all of these news companies, are really eligible to share and discuss about information, like scientific information, medical information that they're not really educated for? They just can't share a part of information that makes news, such as, for example, the statistics of COVID-19, but necessarily the advice that the people need in order to adapt to the situation. They're not really eligible and really educated to be able to do that. Even presidents of countries, even people who are at a really high ranking situation, they don't have the capacity, the intellectual capacity and knowledge to be able to lead in such a situation. So I was wondering that if we could actually envision some kind of different narrative in this situation, whether more scientists need to be in this power position and lead the way.
Many news channels invite doctors or scientists on their programs, but they invite the people who they want. So it's still the same. They are promoting an opinion or a site point of view that is scientific, but it's only one part of science. They don't tend to present the opposite point of view. So this is still something that the media are doing. They still promote something, even by using scientists, but not the right, okay, not both sides of the argument. They only present one, so the problem remains.
So in a way, it's the whole system somehow needs to be to have some new sets of values. And I think given the talk, it's about new sets of values that we can learn and envision for after post COVID-19. What is the alternative? I mean, one way is to basically describe the situation. This is a situation and it's not working clearly. But what kind of steps or what kind of solutions do we have in order to change?
Just to be controversial, if they present some aspects of the facts, how does it matter? Why does it matter to us? Why does it matter to people if they don't have the full truth? Because then we get into what is truth. If they say to me that, for example, today we had 100 new cases and this is going to cause panic, maybe it's a true fact or maybe it isn't a true fact. We need to see the result of that action. How does that impact on society and humanity at large? So what I'm saying is we are not searching for one truth that is absolutely true fact. If it doesn't affect our reaction afterwards. Do you understand what I mean? So if what we are hearing from the media is not the absolute truth, it won't matter unless it causes us harm. If it doesn't cause us harm, maybe it wouldn't matter. Why should it matter if it's not true?
Well, I think I understand. I think the point that you're making, I mean, false information or fake information, I think there aren't some new things that we're facing. I mean, in the past, I think the more access we give to people to kind of to have this independent platform to share information, the more the probability of actually some false information to be emerging, because everyone is trying to kind of to share something. And given the dynamics and how these the algorithms behind these platforms are made, I think they kind of push people in a way that to actually post something that is more controversial, share something that is more, maybe has a little bit of misinformation involved and engage with it in order to increase the audience. So it's kind of a, what I can see is that it seems that it is a system of information sharing that is resilient in a not desirable way, that actually promotes certain kind of sharing, promotes certain kind of behavior on social media platforms and other spaces. There is a question for you, Marius, on the from the audience, is that that I see Cyprus has a low numbers, 15 deaths and 889 cases. The situation there are different than here, plus why? So why the situation is different in Cyprus, basically?
You're touching a difficult subject for me, because I'll explain. First of all, the country went into a total lockdown. There wasn't allowed, nobody was allowed to go out for several weeks. I used to go out because of the being a doctor, and there was nobody at all in the streets. So strict isolation policies. 15 deaths, in my view, they've been attributed to COVID, whereas they are not due to COVID. In other words, the deaths are even less than those 15, because if somebody dies from cancer and they have coincidentally being diagnosed positive for COVID, they put it down as COVID-related death, so it shows in that number. But what we want is to know how many people the virus kills. That's what I think. That's the final point that we need to know. So if it wasn't for the virus, how many people would survive? So basically, yes, the number is less than 15. And the cases, even for Cyprus, are quite a lot, because we did large testing programs. So the government identified a lot of positive asymptomatic people. And also because it's an island, we just closed all the airports, and that was it. Whatever wasn't closed, it was easily manageable. So basically, the island, the geographic position of the country helped a lot.
Thank you. There is also a question for Francis that is that you explained about assuming COVID-19 as a shock, as an extreme shock. How can we get from shock to your proposed solution? So the solution that you provide, such as offer networks or other solutions that you explained, basic income and other solutions that you said. And another question is that on nationalism, rather chance of more borders out of fear of what provided. So the comment is that I don't understand this question. If you clarify the question on the chat box, so I can ask the question better. I don't understand the second question. But the first question is that from the perspective that you mentioned, Francis, that you offered a series of solutions, positive solutions, an outcome that might emerge after COVID-19. What can we, how can we get from the situation that we are right now to the picture that, of future that you envisioned?
Well, that's the problem with shocks. Shocks have a kind of a random effect. They shake things up. So they may make certain things more doable, but there is no obvious causal mechanism to go from the shock to the solution. What I kind of just wanted to say is that the shock exposes some of the weaknesses in the old system. Once people get aware of these weaknesses, they will be more motivated to seek for ways to remedy those weaknesses, and the solutions, basic income, etc., which I proposed, are possible solutions. Of these, I think the basic income had already quite a big momentum. So it's the one that is maybe most likely to be boosted by it. The offer networks, it's still something quite experimental. So there is no immediate connection from COVID to a promotion of offer networks. But once you start questioning the whole capitalist logic, then you would also more be open to this offer network logic. As to the second question, which I do understand, to create more nationalism, there is indeed a tendency to close borders, but that's a short-term tendency in the sense that when the virus is spreading and you have the luck, for example, like Mario, that you live on an island, it's pretty easy to close the borders, and that will immediately very much reduce the chances. On the other hand, we know that this is really a pandemic. That means it's everywhere. I don't think there's a single country in the world that doesn't have it. So it doesn't make sense closing borders if it's already inside the border. So the nationalist reflex may indeed be to some degree stimulated in the short term, because people are thinking, yes, but it's because of the stupid Chinese that we got it, or the Americans may think, yeah, it's because of the Europeans that we got it. But once the virus is spread over the whole world, which is the case, and still there are local differences that some countries have it more than others, but it's clear that even the countries that have it the least will see it spread. There is no way at this moment to stop it completely. Unless maybe you take these absolutely drastic measures like in China, where apparently they have managed to do that, but there you need kind of a totalitarian system to be able to do it. So I think that the idea of closing borders to stop it, it simply doesn't work in the long term. In the long term, everybody needs to collaborate on finding a vaccine, on developing a good strategy, on making available all the different tools like respirators, etc. So in that sense, I think that after this first tendency of closing the borders, there will be more of an of a motivation to work together. For example, to strengthen bodies like the World Health Organization. There has been some criticism on the World Health Organization, but the criticism should teach us not that we don't need the World Health Organization, but all that we need more World Health Organization, more and better World Health Organization.
Thank you. So I there is also a question here online that I would like to, this is a question for Cadell. This is a question about lucid dreaming. So how can you, do you have a specific procedure? How do you activate lucid dreaming and how do you cultivate it in your consciousness? Is this is there any specific method or reference that you would suggest to the audience?
Yeah, there's a few ways in which you can increase the likelihood of having a lucid dream. There's really two important steps in becoming a lucid dreamer. The first is increasing the probability that while you're dreaming, you'll consciously recognize you're dreaming. And then the second aspect is once you've consciously recognized you're dreaming, being able to maintain the dream state. That's a very difficult one for me personally, because once you're consciously aware that you're in a dream state, oftentimes you'll wake up. So it's hard to get that second step. But anyway, some of the things you can do is, first one, most important, keep a dream journal. The first thing you do when you wake up, write down your dreams. You'll get better and better and better and better at remembering your dreams and bringing that information to consciousness, which will increase the probability that you can activate the state of consciousness while you're dreaming itself. The second thing, which I mentioned during the presentation, is throughout your waking hours, simply start asking yourself if you're dreaming or not. This will become an unconscious repetition. If you do this for a week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks, every day, some point in your day, maybe one or two times a day, start asking yourself, am I dreaming right now? You know, and then you'll start doing that in your dream. And when you start doing that in your dream, you'll recognize, oh, I'm actually dreaming. So if you reach that stage, that's again the crucial moment where can you maintain it or not? The third thing is to set a very minimal type of alarm where you'll just be able to hear a sound, but not enough to wake you up. And that sound should be able to penetrate your dream. So you might start hearing a little phone ring, or you might start hearing a buzz in your dream, and that can be a cue. So these are some of the things that I've been playing with. But again, that's something that I'm really starting to dip my toes into the waters of.
Okay, so thank you, Cadell, for sharing this answer. While I was listening to three of your presentations, it seems that, Cadell, you provided this perspective at micro scale, that during the time that we're being advised to do social distancing, staying at home, and basically being isolated from the rest of our communities, our society, and network, or what have you. We are given this chance. I mean, for some people, it's not really. It doesn't present itself as an opportunity, but as a space to really explore our inner selves and discover our internal world, so to speak. So you're presenting this perspective as you as an individual are exploring these different realms of consciousness expansion, if you like. So at the same time, Marius was explaining this perspective from the crisis in the medical world and the vulnerabilities that crisis at that level is present itself. Presents to us the vulnerability of community at large, but at individual level, there are activities that you mentioned that you're taking as an individual to increase your own consciousness, to enhance your resilience and adaptation. And on the other hand, Francis is suggesting these solutions that, given this crisis of COVID-19 as an extreme shock, it might actually pushes us out of this previous equilibrium. So what I would like us to now kind of discuss about is that we are having this a potentially positive a change at an individual level, but at the same time we have an inequality and also dysfunction at the level of collective. So there is this gap between personal transformation toward developing new sets of values for post-COVID-19, but at the same time, we have problems at collective level. How can we bridge that? If any of you want to share something, you're more than welcome.
Can I say something? The collective is made up by individuals. So if all individuals are positive and they see things in a constructive way, that will reflect on the collective eventually. But that's an ideal situation. In reality, there are many people who just don't want to know. And this ties in with something it was said earlier, that we need to inform individuals. Many people don't want to know all the details. They just want to know what to do. Shall I stay at home? Shall I get out? Shall I use this medication? Shall I do this exercise? Quite a large number of people just want to be told what to do. So maybe, I don't know if we need to address this or if we just let it be and continue developing ourselves at an individual level. That's just an open question for me. I don't know if somebody wants to comment.
I think one aspect that maybe bridges some of what I was saying with what maybe more Marios and Francis were saying is that on the political and on the economic and on the social level, I don't think things operate as like right and wrong or true and false in a binary way. I think there's just a tension that manifests, and really interpretation or you know, wise political, social, economic interpretation is being able to perceive a way to productively engage with a certain tension that's manifesting. So, I mean, I think that can be expressed in many ways through sort of what Francis was saying about, you know, being able to perceive certain weaknesses that are revealed through a shock in order to strengthen the system. But then for me on the level of ethics, sometimes two people, two scientists, two whatever, can see the same event and come up with totally different ethical interpretations of how to act. And I don't think that there's any way to erase that phenomenon. I think that it's basically the old problem of facts and values, or you can't derive an ought from an is, but that there's always going to be a tension on the level of collective social interpretation of the truth. And I think that we're just going to have to reconcile ourselves with that. And I guess what I'm saying is the bridge is that when you focus on the body and when you focus on your own consciousness, it can maybe help you inside to deal with the ongoing social, political, economic tension, and not to get over identified with it in such a way that it you know, starts to be a stress on your body and starts to cause anxiety and starts to cause other sorts of emotional turmoil.
Well, Francis,
I was trying to unmute myself in the wrong button. I thought that Cadell's approach was interesting because, in a sense, what he describes at the individual level is what I was trying to describe at the social level. That means that it's a shock to the system also that the individual system, and one way to react to it on the individual level is to do these kind of techniques that he was speaking about, techniques that are in a sense intended to be shocks, like psychedelic is supposed to kind of shake your brain in a way to make it think in a different way. Getting a cold shower is shaking up your whole body. The fact that you are out of your routine because of the fact that, for example, you can't go to work and see the usual people in the usual ways opens you up to these kind of unusual experiences. And that may indeed have an effect that also mentally, psychologically, maybe you discover some new aspects of yourself and maybe get out of an equilibrium that was shallow into a more deeper one. It can have that effect, and I wouldn't be surprised if after that lockdown of several months, a couple of people will have understood themselves better, will have found out more about themselves just because they have been forced to be more with themselves rather than just be that part of society where you always interact in the same way with the same people according to the same norms. Forcing yourself to be alone in a sense or with just one or two family members, it does also, it's a shock to the system. It may make you think about things, it may make you aware of things that even if you don't do specific things like meditation or psychedelics, it may have that effect. I just hope that people don't just use it to only check the social media and take in some more false news and some more addictive games.
Well, thank you so much to all of you for sharing your insights. We're approaching toward the end of our gathering, and with that, I wanted to ask you, given the subject of our talk about new sets of values that might emerge after COVID-19, and I would like to start with you, Marius, please. What do you see the medical community? What are the lessons to be learned? Of course, the pandemic is still ongoing, but what are the lessons? And I think the new values that you think that the medical industry or medical community need to integrate into for future?
Well, the values are the same as those promoted by Hippocrates. They haven't changed. The medical values haven't changed, but they depend a lot on money and financial interests. So we all know that we need to have a good hospital, well equipped with top quality doctors. And that's why we saw quite a lot of people getting ill, dying, because we didn't have good quality hospitals and good quality doctors. But it's the financial interest that stops that from occurring. So I don't know if we learn something. Personally, I realized something that I knew already, that the medical ideas are there, but they depend on many other factors which we as doctors or medical personnel cannot easily change. So probably nothing, I would say.
Okay, so do you think that giving more of space to a medical medical basically practitioners in decision makings might be an impact for future, for
yes.
example, have some more leadership power?
That's a very obvious need, and we've seen it now because many advisory panels to the government are made up by only one set of people, epidemiologists and virologists. There are no psychologists to advise on the effects of the lockdown. There are no other specialties. So appointing different high quality people in the different panels on different committees, that would be a very positive thing.
And what about, for example, as we see now, right now, there's a lot of focus on accelerating the testing process and also vaccination. Do you think that this is a right way of focus for future? If, for example, the pandemic is going to be around, let's say, for another year, but do you think that this is the right way of funding research, or do we need to shift our attention to other areas, such as like psychological well-being or something else?
Well, psychological factors kill people. Yesterday, I saw somebody who killed himself because of the lockdown. So that's one thing. Psychology and the effects have to be looked at. But on the other hand, we also need to know how many, we need to have more information about the pandemic. And this is only going to be done with testing large numbers of people, but also testing them with the right amount of tests. I was reading yesterday about somebody in Africa, Tanzania, who was it, the president of Tanzania, who tested a goat and a papaya fruit, and they sent it for testing and it came back positive. So a goat and a papaya fruit are positive for COVID. So that shows you how reliable the tests are. So we need to be careful to use the right tests to have the right information.
Thank you very much, Marius, for your contribution. And I would like to move to Cadell. So you're a philosopher, but I had the pleasure of being your colleague, so I know a little bit of your research. At the same time, I know that you're having this very interesting online academy that you provide courses for individuals. So kind of you're democratizing philosophy, if I may. How do you see COVID-19 can help young scientists to use this opportunity as a way of bringing more of science in a more accessible way to public?
Well, I think that it's kind of like I was looking at Carl Sagan's old book, I think Demon Haunted World, where he was saying that we've built a society dependent upon science, but we've done a poor job of building scientific literacy into the public consciousness. And, you know, an event like COVID-19 means that we do need a greater democratization of sort of general scientific knowledge in terms of like what are like the basic scientific principles, because, you know, in order to have an informed opinion about what's going on, you have to have a basic knowledge of, you know, what is a virus, how does it spread, you know, what are the possible ways to combat it, you know, how do I responsibly take care of my body and my society in a medically informed way. And I think that due to some of the reasons that Marios is highlighting, you know, the ambiguity of testing, you know, the how much can we rely on these tests, the political social dimensions, that we see in this gap the tendency to extreme conspiracy theories and all sorts of strange conjectures which have some weird element of truth to them, but at the same time mislead people more than inform people. So I think that when we experience an event like this, there is a call to future philosophers, scientists, educators in general, to commit themselves to a praxis of trying to raise public consciousness about the scientific method and about critical thinking and all of these different problems, which in part we're doing or trying to do with, you know, Clea, Echo, School of Thinking type projects, your project with resilience, you know, so all of these dimensions, I'd imagine, are going to become more important and should become a bigger part of our society, if only so that we can combat, which in my view is one of the biggest problems, which is the tendency during this time to conspiracy theory. And I think that the tendency towards conspiracy theory simply emerges out of a combination of, on an emotional level, fear and uncertainty, but on an intellectual level, simply not having the right tools to interpret a complex, uncertain situation.
Well, thank you so much for your answer, and I think you really I think you concluded it rather perfectly, because I was now I'm moving to Francis. I wanted to ask you, Francis, given your background in complexity science and cybernetics, and given this the complexity of the situation with COVID-19. How do you see that future governments, future entrepreneurs, basically future societies after COVID-19 can learn from, can adopt a complexity perspective?
That's a difficult question. I wish they would adopt, of course, a more complexity perspective, but it's not that the complexity perspective has all the answers. I mean, what complexity teaches us, among others, is that there is things like the butterfly effect, non-linearity and chaos, which means that things like this COVID pandemic, they're very difficult to predict. There are certain things you can check and that you have to check, like Marius was speaking about testing. One of the most important things we should do, I think, is random testing in order to get an idea of which percentage of the people actually fall seriously ill, because at the moment the people that are tested are the ones that are seriously ill, and the percentage of those that die is high. But probably there are lots of people who have the virus without falling ill. So in a sense that, I mean, it's one very simple application of complexity thinking. It's not because you see strong effects in one particular group that you can extrapolate to everybody. You need some random testing. But in general, how can governments from this come to more of a complexity perspective? Well, one of the things I think everybody by now will have learned, that is that epidemics spread to a positive feedback process. The more people are infected, the more get infected, which is why you typically describe the spread of a disease on a logarithmic scale rather than on a linear scale. So I hope that's one of the things some people may take from it, which is one of the typical examples of complexity thinking. Also, the fact that such a positive feedback necessarily comes to a halt, because you cannot infect more than the whole population. So that means at the end it's a sigmoid curve, another typical complexity perspective. Then the fact that all things are connected, that the disease not only has an effect on people's health, but also on the psychological health, on the economic activities, on the well-being of society, how all these things interact, are connected, and may feedback on each other in a positive or in a negative way. These are also things that hopefully we will better understand afterwards. We see them happening at the moment, but at the moment they're going so quickly that we can't really see what will be the effect on what. That's also why my own suggestion of what may happen as positive effects, it's very much may. I don't say this will happen. I say it could happen, and there may be other things that I haven't foreseen, either positive or negative, that will happen instead. That is part of what a complex system is. But some of the simpler mechanisms of like positive feedback, interconnection, spread from one domain to another domain, these are things we see happening, and hopefully that people will also understand. The false news actually is the same problem as the epidemic. False news spreads via a positive feedback. The more people see something, the more people spread it, and the more people speak about it, the more it's further spread. It's the same, it's in this case the same mechanism, and that's also why you will need the same kind of measures to deal with it. measures such as firewalls, like, for example, not letting something spread more than a certain amount or building in some kind of a fiction. That reminds me, one of the best proposals that was made to combat financial crisis was the Tobin tax. The Tobin tax is a kind of an artificial way to slow down this positive feedback of speculation. Speculation is a stock is going up in value, therefore more people buy it, therefore it goes more up, therefore more people buy it, and you have again this runaway process that can't be controlled. But if there is a small tax, that if you buy something, you pay a small tax, you will not buy as quickly and you will slow down the whole process. It's a bit the same as social distancing. Social distancing is a way to slow down the spread of the epidemic. It cannot stop it, in the sense that people do need to contact other people sooner or later, but it slows it down enough to keep it manageable. So generally speaking, I think maybe one of the lessons that everybody could draw from it is that when you are in a situation where something may be explosive, meaning that you have a chain reaction that goes faster and faster, whether it's the spread of false news, the spread of a virus, or the spread of speculative increase in a value, you should build in processes to slow it down, kind of artificial friction. Artificial friction, or what is sometimes called firewalls, meaning borders so that it can't spread across that border, that are some of the simple measures that are inspired directly by complexity thinking. So maybe that's one lesson we will learn from it.
Thank you so much to all of you and for the audience for joining today. We are now approaching to the end of our discussion. And I will, we have a couple of minutes left. And if anyone has some final notes, please grab the microphone and share.
Well, I just wanted to say that it is a good thing we had this pandemic, because now we had the opportunity to be together and discuss it. And I haven't seen you for a long time, so it's an opportunity to see you now and say hello. Mm-hmm. So yeah, there is something positive.
Well, thank you so much. And I hope that you're all keeping safe and staying at home. And I, with that said, we are now at the end of our talk and discussion. I see you later. Thank you so much. Goodbye.
Thanks, everyone.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.